nor things present, nor things to come, nor
all
heaven,
right,
nor death,
yes,
nor
sir,
any other creature shall be able.
Beautiful song there. We're going to be coming back to it. But pleasant afternoon to those of you in Zoom land here at Valley Stream tonight. We again praise God for you and with you. We want to welcome you to this segment of prayer. And we just want you to know that there are so many things to be praying for. So be ready to pray in a moment. We're going to take a song and we'll get right back to prayer. And there are just so many different things, and we are going to be reminded just before we pray. But let's take the song, and then we'll get right back to our prayer segment. Certainly a wonderful song, Give Me a Heart Like Thine. As we go to prayer tonight, there are just so many things that we need to be praying for. We want to again remember our brother Derek and family. We want to continue to lift them up in prayer. Brother Derek's sister also, we want to continue to pray for. Remember those who are still in the whole process of grieving. We pray for them that the Lord will give them strength, the Janssen family, the Hosang family, right here in our local congregation. I want to remember Dwayne, heard he's doing much better, but we still want to continue to lift him up in prayer. The Becker family, we want to continue to pray for them. Sister Rosalie and family, we want to continue to pray God's blessings on them and so many other things going on around us. Sister Stella, Sister Gloria, Sister Lily Boynes, and so on. But let's continue to lift up each other in prayer. Let's pray about our re-entry as we think of coming back on October the 4th. We're still making preparation for such, and we're still seeking the Lord's divine will in such. Now, as we continue to pray, we want to just be drawn closer to the Lord each moment of the day. I don't know if anyone wants to begin tonight. Just go right ahead and just begin to pray. Utilize the time God has given us. Just unmute your mic and just go right ahead and pray. Saints of God. Anybody?
Our Father in heaven, we bless your holy name. Tonight we come to you, Lord, humbly at your feet. We lift you up on high. We give you the glory. Father, there's none like unto you. You are a faithful God. Great is your faithfulness. Your great and greatly should be praised. We just want to thank you that we can come together tonight once more to give you all the praise and all the honor. Tonight we pray, Almighty God, for Pastor Park, your servant. May you continue to strengthen him, give him wisdom as he prepares, Lord, to open, to start the church once more, to get the congregation together, to lead us, dear Lord. We pray that you will bless his family, bless Sister Nadine, the children, put a hedge around them. We pray, Almighty God, for Pastor Anthony and his family, Pastor Hutchison and his family. May you bless them as they continue in the ministerial work. We pray for the deacons and family, trustees and family, and we say thank you, Father. Bless them all. We pray, Almighty God, for all those who are sick, all those who are afflicted. May you continue to touch their bodies with your healing power from the crown of their head to the soles of their feet, physically, spiritually, emotionally. For those who are waiting for employment, you provide for the birds, so much more you'll provide for us. Lord, we believe and we know you'll take care of us. We pray for Duane, who is about to travel up from Florida. Dear God, we pray for traveling mercies for Sister Yvonne, Doreen, as they come back from Florida with Duane, dear Lord. We pray your mercies upon them and guide them. We continue to pray for such times in our life, the troubling times. But you said, Lord, we will overcome. We pray, your words teach us to pray in one accord. We thank you for your unconditional love. And we pray that you'll help us to do the things that will edify us. We thank you for your encouraging and comforting words. There is so much unsettling in these days, Lord, and we pray for peace throughout this land, a peace that passeth all understanding, a peace that guards our minds and our hearts. Here we are, dear God, in an emotional uproar. We thank you for the storms of life that may come raging around us, but we know you will strengthen us. And we pray that our emotions will be on an anchor that is safe, secure, and unchanging. Our hope is in you, O Lord. And we pray for a supernatural blessing that we all may experience oneness. I pray that you continue to open your windows of heaven and pour your blessings upon us. And we continue to give you the praise, the glory, the honor, and we ask this in the precious and mighty name of Jesus. Amen and amen.
Anybody else wants to go right ahead and pray? So many things to pray for. God is an awesome God. Our Father, we are so grateful tonight to be able to bow in prayer before you and thanking you for your goodness and your tender mercies towards us. When I looked up in the skies today and I saw that plane flying overhead, I just wondered in my mind how many people were in that plane and what are they thinking? Where are they coming from? And how happy they must have been realizing that they arrived almost at Kennedy. You are such a good God. God, you're amazing in all the things that you do and all the things that you accomplish through man and in our lives. Tonight we present all our situations before you, no matter what they are. We know that, as we mentioned as always, that indeed you are the great physician, the sympathizing Jesus. Lord, we praise you tonight for all that you've been doing. I lift up our brother Mills before you tonight. Lord, you are an awesome God at all times. And tonight we praise you for him. We pray you continue to touch our brother, dear God, and touch his eyes, Lord, as he specifically needs your touch on his eyes. We pray that your glory will fall on him in this respect. We pray for Sister Lily Bowens, likewise, that you continue to touch this blessed sister, dear God, and Sister Gloria, Sister Stella, be with them, Almighty God. We know that there comes a time for us as we get older in life, and we may not be able to move around effectively as we once did. But that should not dim our relationship with you. David mentioned he's hid the word in his heart that he might not sin against thee. And so we pray that you'll surround them with your goodness and your love and be with them and strengthen them. Remember Sister Paula's grandmother too, lady well up in age, but a woman that knows you. We pray her strengthen you, that you'll continue to be with her, dear God, in a very special way. We think of this great country, America, and all the things that are happening around us. Help us not to be carried away with the system that is in place within the world, but help us to be focused on you, knowing that, Lord, man trusts in horses and chariots and all sorts of things, but we are trusting in the living and holy God. God, tonight we thank you for the relationship that you granted to us as a gift, and that we'll be able to be reconciled with you. We can come, we can talk to you, we can sing songs and bring melody in our hearts. We could praise you. We could read the word and be enriched in our hearts. Father, we bless your holy name. We pray for this great congregation, this body of people to which you perpetually set aside over time, a people that you have called Almighty God and sanctified through your words. Almighty God, we pray your blessings on them. We thank you for the sacrifices that they have made to make this a success here at Valley Stream. We pray that you'll be with them on their journey and all the difficulties in life that they might face. Help them to recognize that nothing, no matter what it is, comes to us by accident. but you are there to guide, you're there to lead the way for us. We pray as we plan our re-entry in this place. Almighty God, I'm not looking to come here for that Sunday for any special worship. Why not? Because I have been walking with you. You have been giving me the strength and the grace to continue. And the church was not closed. The building, but the church was not closed. The church has always been alive and well and active. Good God Almighty. And we just need to realize that, Lord, we praise you wherever we are. We are the temple of God, not the building. I am the temple. Bible said the Spirit of God lives in me. Bless the many who have joined us tonight in prayer and study. We pray for your servant that is set aside to bring forth your word. We pray your blessings on him. We pray for Pastor Hutchinson that you'd be with him and his family continually. We pray for the leadership, the deacons and their family. We pray that you'd be with them, the trustees and the membership in general, and our extended Valley Stream members we commend before the throne of grace. Pray for our brother that will be going to Jamaica. Lord, I don't know if it's this month or the coming month, but whatever time it is, to set his brother aside in the funeral service that is being planned. We pray for their safety. Bless tonight. Remember my family, I commend them before you. I thank you for them. Thank you for my wife. And Lord, just continue to be with her and give her the strength that she needs. And my kids, Lord, to be able to grow in your grace and in the knowledge of the word of God. We thank you for all the prayers that you've answered for us, that we cried out to you for. You heard us. We thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hallelujah. Oh, glory be to God. Heavenly and eternal Father, oh God, as we come before your throne of grace and mercy, just giving you thanks and praise, oh God, for who you are. Oh God, when we rise each day, oh God, is so much to give you praise for. But Father, we lift each heart and mind, oh God. Father, we pray, oh God, for revival, oh God. Father, as Jacob had said when he saw Joseph, oh God, revive. He was revived, oh God. I pray for revival in our spirit, oh God. Father, despite of every circumstances, despite of every situation, oh God, we are still able, oh God, to give you praise and thanks and honor and glory, oh God. Father, you're such a merciful God. You're such a compassionate and loving Father. So, God, tonight we say thank you, oh God. Thank you for your mercy and your grace, oh God. Father, we live up, oh God, we lift up the body, the congregation before your throne. We pray, oh God, that you have your will and way in the members, oh God. I pray for hearts, oh God, that have been seeking your face, oh God. I pray that you touch them, oh God, from the crown of their head to the sole of their feet. I pray, oh God, that you anoint them, Father, whether it be illness, oh God. Father, for loss, oh God, of family and loved ones, I pray that you strengthen them, oh God. Father, I know it's not easy, oh God, but Father, you said, oh God, that you are the great comforter, and oh God, we look to you tonight. Father, we lift up the ministry, oh God, before you, every aspect of it, oh God. Father, you know it, oh God, by name. I pray, oh God, that you touch each individual, oh God, that participate, oh God, in the ministry. Oh God, I pray that you anoint them, oh God. Father, I pray, oh God, that you touch them from the crown of their head to the sole of their feet. I thank you, oh God, for our pastor, our leader, oh God, our under shepherd, oh God. I pray that you continue touching him. Oh God, we pray, oh God, that you continue using him in a mighty way. We pray, oh God, for the other pastors, oh God. We pray for the deacons and their family, oh God. We pray, oh God, for marriages, oh God. We pray, oh God, for finance, oh God. We pray for healing, oh God, in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you, oh God, for who you are this evening, oh God. We lift up, oh God, the service before your blessed throne. We pray that the word that is going to go forth, oh God, tonight would touch our hearts and our minds, oh God. Help us, oh God, to seek you, oh God, more than ever. Help us to hold on to you, God, despite our circumstances.
oh God, despite of what we are going through, despite of what we are faced with, Father, oh God, hold on to you, oh God. And Father, we give you the honor this hour. We give you the glory, oh God, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Anybody else? Bless the name of Jesus.
Father, Lord, I'm just thankful to you for this time. Are we able to just come and lift up your name and just lay our petitions before you? And I just pray that at this very hour, dear Lord, we will just be on one accord, that we will have put aside any distractions, anything that will hinder us from receiving your word tonight. And dear Lord, I just pray that you just continue to just do your work in us, dear Lord, so we can do your work for us.
Heavenly Father, I want to thank you, Lord, for all that you've done for us and all that you're doing for us.
Go right ahead, whoever is praying. Go right ahead. Who is that? Oh, it's Sister Paula. Okay. Oh, okay, I see. Go ahead, Sister Paula. Sorry about the pass watching song. So Paula was with.
Yes, can you hear me, Pastor?
Yeah, we can hardly hear you, Sister Paula. That's why Pastor Hutchinson can
hear. Yeah, that's
hear.
Why he, yeah.
No, okay, let me try to turn it up.
Yeah, we can. Try it again, Sister Paula.
Can you hear me? Or it's really low.
You go ahead, I can hear a little clearer now.
Okay. I'm going to switch to the other computer. Hold on one moment.
Okay.
Yes, hello?
Yes, go ahead.
Yes, Heavenly Father, Lord, I come to just say thank you for your grace and your mercy that continues to carry us through from day to day. I thank you for this opportunity to come before you in prayer. I know that your presence is here, for you say where two or three are gathered, you are in the midst, and nothing that the enemy tries to come to hinder, block any prayers that come before you can take place if you are in the midst and if we come with a surrendered heart. And dear Lord, I come with my heart surrendered. I come with a genuine heart, lifting up my brothers and sisters in prayer. Dear Lord, you know all the needs, dear Lord, for each person who is on right at this very moment, and even those who are not able to physically join us tonight. And I just pray that according to your will, you will answer every single prayer. And I pray, regardless of the response, dear Lord, regardless of the answer received, that we will know that you, in your word, you say that you don't come to harm us, but for us to prosper and to give us hope in a future. So we can stand in that promise and know that even when the answer is no, or even at times when you tell us to wait, we can wait patiently knowing that you say that you are going to never leave us nor forsake us and supply all our needs. And so, dear Lord, I come right now laying everyone before you. The names are too many for me to remember, but dear Lord, thank God you are all knowing. And so I just thank you in advance for what you will do in the lives of each and every person who has a need, dear Lord. And I just come to you at this very hour asking you to just continue to be with our pastor, the under shepherd. I pray that he will continue to allow you to order his steps. I pray that nothing surrounding him will be of a distraction, that his eyes will remain stayed on you, so that everything that is done will be done according to your will, and it will be done to your honor and your glory. And I just thank you for what you have done thus far through him. And I pray that you continue to provide him with the strength, dear Lord, that he needs to continue to press on in this assignment that you have given him. I lift his family up to you. I pray that they will continue to stand alongside him, and Sister Nadine to remain that helpmeet who supports him with this calling that you have placed on his life. And dear Lord, I lift up my husband to you even at this very hour as you use him once more to bring forth your word. I pray that as the word goes forth, it will not only provide knowledge, because we know according to your word that knowledge is not enough. It has to provide understanding. We need to understand your word, because we have seen where many in your word has had the knowledge, yet when your word was lived out, when the living word was before them, their eyes were blind because they did not understand. So I pray that you will provide not only knowledge, but understanding to every single person who is here seeking to receive your word tonight. And for those who you have set aside to present today, this evening, dear Lord, I pray anointing upon them. I pray any fears, anything that might be festering up in them, I pray that it be removed. For it's not about them, it's about you, and you have already seen them. You're already pleased with what they have surrendered and accepted. And so they need not to be fearful. And I just pray that whatever is spoken, dear Lord, will be done in clarity so that we can fully receive it, and it will do that which it is intended. Dear Lord, I pray for Pastor Hutchinson. I thank you for the way in which you continue to use him as well. Dear Lord, I pray that the appointed times when you call him to minister, I pray that you will continue to, and he will continue to surrender himself to be used by you. And as he has been used in a way to be such a blessing thus far. And so I just thank you for that. And I thank you that you just continue to just join us together, dear Lord. I pray that this physical separation will not bring forth division or anything that will not keep us bound together and united as not only a local church, but a universal church. Continue to have your way in our lives, dear Lord. I pray this time that you have separated us, dear Lord, that we have used this time to truly seek you and spend time with you in fellowship so that we can fully know your calling on our lives, dear Lord, so that when we do join together, dear Lord, it will be different. It will be different. We will come with a renewed spirit, dear Lord. We will come revived and ready to be used more than ever, ready to be for our territories to be enlarged, because we have taken the time and used our time wisely to grow in our relationship with you. Lord, I love you. I thank you for all that you have done, all that you are doing, all that you will do. I lift up my daughter to you. I thank you for what you are doing in her life, dear Lord. I pray that you'll just continue to be with her and order her steps, dear Lord, and just have your way in her life, dear Lord. Lord, I love you and I thank you. And there's no other name but the mighty name of Jesus that we pray. Amen.
Amen. Pastor Hutchinson, we're going to take yours as the last prayer. It's almost 8 o'clock. All right, so go right ahead. Thank you, Sister Paula.
Heavenly Father, we want to give you thanks, Lord, for your grace and wonderful mercies, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunity once again to gather to study your word. We pray, Heavenly Father, that as we go into our Bible studies tonight, dear Father, I pray, Lord, that you prepare our hearts to receive your word, Heavenly Father. I pray, Heavenly Father, for the one who stands to bring your word tonight, dear God, that there will be much clarity, dear Father, that our hearts will be overjoyed, dear Father, at the going out of your word, dear Lord. May it reach into our hearts and may it be fruitful. May it find roots in our heart, dear Father, where your word will continue to grow as we grow from day to day, dear God. We pray, Heavenly Father, for those who are online tonight. And we pray, Heavenly Father, that you just open up our hearts to receive your word. We pray for our pastors, dear God. We pray for those who are in need of your healing hand, dear God, of your provision, for those who are grieving, Lord, for those who will be traveling to
bury their loved ones, dear Father. For those who are sick, dear God, Lord, we just want to lift up everyone before you tonight, dear God. And I pray, Heavenly Father, that there will be a healing, there will be a comforting, yes, to each and every one. We bless you, Lord, and we praise your holy name. And as we continue to look forward to your coming, amen, we pray, Heavenly Father, that you will prepare our hearts with joy as we wait patiently. In Jesus' precious name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Prayer is so important. Oh my God, as we come together, we can certainly fellowship in this manner. And I want to thank you for sharing with us in this segment of our time of prayer. As I've always said, this is not our only time to pray. We're praying people, and we pray every day. And what a blessing it is to be able to come. Oh my God, there's just so much that God can do and so much that God has done. And we can look back with reflections and the blessings of the Almighty God. God is indeed an awesome God. Amen. All right, we're going to take the song, and then, as usual, we will go directly into our study. Pastor Anthony Mills again will be leading us in our study. I trust that we've come tonight with our vessels empty and ready to be filled, and trust in God that the Lord will just have his own way in our lives. Let's take this song and then go directly to the Word of God.
Heavenly Father, I appreciate you. Heavenly Father, I appreciate you. I love you, adore you, I bow down before you. Heavenly Father, Son of God, what a wonder you are. Son of God, what a wonder you are. You cleanse my soul from sin, set the Holy Spirit within. Son of God, what a wonder you are. Holy Ghost, what a comfort you are. Holy Spirit, what a comfort you are. You lead us as Lord.
That you are
Heavenly Father, I appreciate you.
Stand before the Lord is thus between you and the Lord.
Heavenly Father, I appreciate you. I love you. I bow down before you, Heavenly Father, I appreciate you. Son of God, what a wonder you are. Son of you are. Heavenly Father, we appreciate you.
No matter where you are in the church, you can just praise God wherever you are. It's just awesome. You are a connection.
Yes,
we love you, Lord. We love you, Lord.
We love you, Lord. Heavenly God, we appreciate you.
Hallelujah, Pastor Mills.
Blessed. I am blessed. I am blessed. Every day of my life, I am blessed. Just want to thank the Lord for this great opportunity once again that he has given me that I can stand before the body of Christ. I'm so blessed and honored, and I say that every time. Tonight, we'll be hearing from three people who volunteered as we move to day number five. Pretty much it's the review. It's the review, a summary, I said, you know, off. But I want to wrap up pretty much where I left off, as someone will also be finishing day four, before we move to day five. So the last time we here, I left off at page 39, and you can turn there with me as we commence. We are at the bottom, which we're going to start from Hebrews chapter 4. But before I do that, let us go before the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you for the prayers, dear Lord God, of your loved ones. We thank you, Lord God, that Father, that you have blessed our hearts tonight, that Lord God, we can even hear, Lord God, the voice of those who prayed, Lord God. Father, in a time, Lord God, where, Father, it's unrest that's going on, there is a lot of things that's happening around us, Father, a lot of hopes, dear Heavenly Father, dreams and aspirations, Lord, are dim. But, Lord, we know that in you, Lord God, we know that, Lord God, we have it all. And, Father, as we look around us, dear Lord God, as we read from your word and we look around us and we see things, Lord God, we know, Lord God, that, Father, that our redemption draw nigh, Lord. And I pray, God, that, Lord, that your people, that we will keep, Lord God, our minds stayed in you, Lord God. I pray that, God, that we will maintain that focus, Lord God. I pray, God, that we will not be distracted by the things around us, by the times, Lord God, and what we are facing, Lord, because, Lord, we have, Lord God, you as our anchor, Lord, and we stand on the solid foundation, which is Jesus Christ, that nothing can move, Lord God. So, Father, we pray, Lord God, that, Lord, that you help us, Father, to claim that authority, Father. Oh, God, know, Lord, that we trust, Lord God. When you say nothing will come nigh us, Father God. Father, we can be affected, Lord God, or afflicted, Father, in the body, Father God, physically, Lord. But we know, Almighty God, that those, Lord, who are connected to you, that we have a connection, Almighty God, a connection with you, Lord God, that nobody can break, Lord God, because we are eternally secured. And we pray, Lord, that as we are faced with trials and tribulations and all these things that comes into our lives, Lord God, we pray that, Lord God, that, Lord, we will stand, Lord God, knowing that you are our God. You are immutable, never change. And because we know that, Lord, we, Lord God, stand on your promise, Lord God, your promise of rest, Lord, that as we labor, we know, God, that a day will come, Lord God, when, Father God, those of us, the Heavenly Father, who, Lord God, keep, Lord God, our shoulders to the wheel, Lord God, for those of us, as your word says, who deny, Lord God, flesh, take up the cross, who follow you, Lord God, the day will come when, God Almighty, we know that our labor, Lord God, will not be in vain, that we will see you there, Lord God. Oh, God, we will rule with you, dear Heavenly Father. That is our desire, dear Heavenly Father. Oh, God, we thank you that, Lord, you have chosen us. We thank you, Lord God, that, Father, that, Lord, you never left us alone, God, but by your word, Lord God, you show us each day, Lord God, that your coming is sure. So we go through this study tonight, Lord, I pray that you bless your people, bless your word. As we know that, Lord God, it will not go back unto you, void, Father. It will accomplish its purpose. So we thank you tonight, Lord. Holy Spirit of the living God, take every aspect, Lord. Fill the atmosphere, Almighty God, with your presence. Touch your people, Lord. Sensitize every heart tonight, dear Lord God, to your word. Bless those who have volunteered to, Lord, summarize, Lord, as we move on, Father, in, Lord God, these prophetical accounts that you have laid out in scriptures. We thank you for tonight. We thank you for your blessings. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Amen. I just want to commence. I'd like to read the word of God as we am on page 39. That's where we are, Hebrews chapter 4. And we're going to continue from there as we press on in this study. There are a number of warnings in Hebrews chapter 4. And we want to look up for it as we wrap up this section. Not going to spend a lot of time because I want those who volunteered to have an opportunity to go through. And then I will pick it up at the end and we will close off lesson number 2, building on the foundation, the future foretold by the past, part 1. Hebrews chapter 4, it says, therefore, let us fear, lest while a promise remains of entering his rest, any one of you should seem to have come short of it. For indeed, we have had good news preached to us. I want you to take note of all of these while I go along. Good news preached to us, just as they also. They will find out who, right? But the word they heard did not profit them, right? This first 2 verses is a whole sermon to itself. Amen. Because if we look and we see what is happening, a lot of stuff is happening around us. Of the Hebrews, they were going through great persecution, right? We're talking about Christians, they are going through great persecution. Those who have turned to Christianity, and what happened, they were going through turmoil, a tough time in their lives. And right now, we know also that a lot of people hear the word and it's not profiting us anything. Why happen? Because in our actions, in our relationships, you see that nothing is happening in our lives. But let us continue and then we can pick this up. But the word they heard did not profit them because it was not united by faith in those who heard. For we who have believed enter the rest, just as he has said, as I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest. Although his works were finished from the foundation of the world, for he has thus said somewhere concerning the seventh day, and God rested on the seventh day from all his works, taking us back to the Genesis of time. And again in this passage, they shall not enter my rest, since therefore it remains for some to enter it. And those who formerly had good news preached to them fail to enter because of disobedience. Amen. Going back to the Genesis of time once again, going back to the first generation of Israel. Amen. Which the Bible tells you straight up why this happened. Let me see where it's going to take us now. He again fixes a certain day today, saying through David, after so long a time, just as has been said before, today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. For if Joshua had given them rest, he would not have spoken of another day. After that, there remains therefore a Sabbath rest for the people of God. The Hebrew word for rested is a root word for Sabbath. And it means to cease from business. And as we look, we know that God ceased from his labor. He ceased from his labor. And the Bible says he was refreshed. Amen. And when we look at this, we say, God will need to be refreshed because God is God. But whatever happened in scripture, just remember that it's for our example. You know what? I always say that I'm not saying that I'm jealous over Israel, but I just remember the Israelites, that the Israelites, just them being in the presence of the Lord. Amen. I always said, what would it be like? I'm talking about here they are, they're hearing the voice, and they're seeing the cloud by night and the fire by day, and they're seeing all these things, and I'm saying, wow. What would that be like? But now, what is the difference now? That we have the Lord, the indwelling Holy Spirit in us, that we can get personal with the Lord. Amen? So you see that it's a little different. So what happened is that he ceased from his labor. And the Bible said that he blessed and he sanctified the Sabbath day and he made it holy, right? So what he did, he set this day apart. And when he set this day apart for his glory, and what happened, a lot of times we misinterpret what this all setting apart and what it's all about. But first of all, we know that it was a sign, amen? It is, the rest was a future rest for the people of God. Now, when it comes to the Israelites were supposed to go to the land of Canaan, and that was supposed to be their rest from their labor. But it's more than that. That's just a shadow of what was to come. Amen? The day of rest, as we know, it is a day that God will be honored, but man will be benefited. Amen? I'm just pretty much wrapping up. I think I mentioned this last week, because God is going to be honored, and what happened, man is going to be benefited. So the future rest, it will benefit man. God knew that will be needed. Amen. So Jesus Christ said, Matthew chapter 2:7, the Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. And we know that Jesus, what he was doing, he was attesting here to the fact that just as the Sabbath day was originally instituted to give man rest from his labors, he did come to provide rest from laboring to achieve our own salvation by works. So let me expound a little bit on that, what happened. When we talk about our existence here, everything that we do here, and I say it again, but I want you guys to really understand what our existence here is all about, amen, pertinent to the seventh day, or the day of rest, or the messianic period, as it's called. Everything that we do here, it is geared towards that day, that day of rest. Because we talk about our works and what we do here, all the sacrifices that we do to honor God, what happened is that when we said it before, that we're going to stand before God, we're going to be tried, our work's going to be tested, but guess what? That's all towards our inheritance. And our inheritance, of course it is, it is all about the salvation of God. Our soul, our laboring here is about the salvation of our souls. The salvation of our souls is connected to our works. Amen. The works that we do, it gears towards the salvation of our soul. The salvation of our soul is geared towards our rewards. Amen. What we receive based on what we have done while we exist, while we walking as a part of the body of Christ, while we exist here on earth. Amen? So it's very important for us to understand that and understand pretty much what this is all about. So Hebrews chapter 4 said, let us therefore fear, right? Let us therefore fear. Let us fear. Let us be apprehensive that we may possibly fall of that rest. The kind of fear which is recommended here is what leads to caution and care. So in other words, as you proceed, be careful. Just be careful, because what happened is that you know, you experienced, and you saw what happened to Israel. Amen? As we walk, it is for us to understand. God's desire is for us to walk circumspectly. God's desire is for us to not to fall in the same trap that the Israelites fall in, or where they fell in. Let us therefore fear. And what should they, if we look back, go back into Hebrews and go to Hebrews chapter 3, and I'm going to look at verse, the last verse in chapter 3, chapter 3, verse 18. And to whom swear he that they should not enter into his rest, but to them that believed not. So we see that they could not enter in because of unbelief. So watch it now. So it picks up, and I'm going to expound a little bit when we go into the study. It picks up now from there. So verse, so chapter 4 picks that up, and it says, let us therefore fear. Let me go back to 19, verse 19. So we see that they could not enter in because of unbelief. Chapter 4 now says, let us therefore fear, watch this now, lest a promise be left us of entering into his rest, any of you should seem to come short of it. It is important. Let's continue. So he again fixes a certain day. And he says, today, saying through David, after so long a time, just as been, and therefore today, if you hear his voice, harden not your hearts. Now, if you go back to on page 38, Psalms 95, if we look at verse 7 of Psalms 95 and verse 7 of Hebrews chapter 4, it is the same thing that was said there. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture. We're talking, this is David now. And the sheep of his hand. Today, if you would hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. This is David, and David is going back, way back to the first generation. And if we come back to Hebrews chapter 4 now, this is New Testament. Verse 7, he says, he again fixes a certain day, today saying through David, after so long a time, just as he has been said before, today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. So David, as you know, Joshua, what happened is that the first generation did not enter. Amen? Right? So the Hebrews now, they brought, it brought us to attention now. The first generation, what happened is that God planned for them that they should enter his rest. Amen? And his rest, that they would rest from their labor in Canaan. Amen? But what happened is that they disobeyed God through their lack of faithfulness. And as a result of that, they forfeit that rest. They never enter the promised land, Canaan. So here it is now that we're picking up. So the question is, was the promised land in Canaan, the seventh-day rest, was it there? Was that the ultimate rest that God promised Israel? Absolutely not. It wasn't. So it was a picture. It was a sign of a seventh-day rest. Canaan was just the earthly land where God would dwell in their presence, and what would happen is that he would rule. Amen? So I want to go back as I wrap this up now. I want to follow pretty much, there's some very important point within the writer's study here that I want to bring out to you. So before we move on and close this session, ask the others to jump in a little bit. So I want you to follow me. Go to the second paragraph. It said, yet was the rest in the land of Canaan, the promised land, the seventh-day rest which God had ultimately planned for them. And it says, no, that it was not. The rest in the land of Canaan was to be, but as I just mentioned, but a picture for them of the seventh-day rest which lay out ahead. It was a sign. Though there certainly was a rest before them in an earthly land wherein God would dwell in their presence and would rule in a theocracy with Israel as the head of all the nations. So as we know that God's design for Israel, that Israel was supposed to be the example to lead the nations, amen, by example. But what happened is that they fell in disobedience, and as a result of that, they forfeit that which God has promised them. So the rest that Joshua led the second generation into, of which the first generation fell short of due to disobedience, was only a picture of the coming rest in which God will lead his people. He will lead them into a heavenly promised land, dwell in the midst of his people in the person of Christ, and rule in a theocracy with Christ and his bride, ruling over all the nations. So they forfeited, and of course it is, we're going to see that in the messianic period, what happened is that this is going to be fulfilled where Christ and his bride will rule. Amen, somebody. And that is the rest of your future for the people of God. That is the rest of which we are warned not to fall short of, as the children of Israel fell short of. And this warning is given to us in several New Testament passage. And we see that throughout. We see it in Psalms chapter 95. We see it in Hebrews chapter 4 and many other New Testament passages. We warn, the Lord warn us, not only that, but in other words, deny yourself, take up the cross. We should walk in this obedience. We should walk circumspectly, because what happened, honor and glory belongs to God, and we are just heading to that day when we will rule with Christ, right? So if we look now, if we go back now, when we look and we notice that in Hebrews chapter 4, it begins with the word therefore. And this word connects what the author had just said in chapter 3 to what he's getting ready to say in chapter 4. I want to read that again for you to understand that, because this is very important. This is the last paragraph now. Right? This is the last paragraph, right? Hebrews chapter 4. We want to take notice of this, that in Hebrews chapter 4, and I touch a little piece of it, but the writer is expounding on it now. So that's why it's important for us to stick to the reading, because there are some very important things that we can pull out of it. So notice that Hebrews chapter 4, it begins with the word therefore, right? This word, what it does, it connects what the author had just said in chapter 3 to what he's getting ready to say in chapter 4. Am I? So there's a connection. So chapter 3 is a preparation for pretty much what is to come in chapter 4. In chapter 3, he gave the experience of the children of Israel as an example to his readers in the way of a warning to us concerning the possibility of our missing out on the rest yet future. And we're not going to go back to it, but it will tell you that especially in verse 7, he says, he again fixes a certain day, and that day is the day of rest. That is the day that was promised all the way back in Genesis, based on the seventh day that is mentioned. But he says that today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. And that is pretty much a warning. If you hear his voice, it was a warning then. It's a warning to the people of God. If you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts, right? If you hear his voice, don't harden your hearts, because what happened, you will fall in the same trap, amen? We have to fear God, amen? Keep his commandment, because what happened, if we go back and we fail to listen to him, to listen to his guidance through his word, then of course, I guarantee you that we're going to fall into the same trap. Let us continue. Having addressed this section to those who are called to a heavenly calling, Hebrews chapter 3 verse 1, the author of the book of Hebrews challenges readers in the opening words of verse 4:1, concerning something they were to fear. What were they to fear? What are we to fear? Well, we have to fear that we do not fall into the same trap and lose out. Of course it is. We, as I mentioned, that we can lose. There are some things that a lot of us, we're going to lose. Amen, somebody. But guess what? It doesn't have to be like that. We have to pay attention to what God is saying in his word. If not, we're going to fall into the same trap that Israel fell in. So in Hebrews chapter, on page 41, in Hebrews chapter 4:3-4, to what time period does the order relate the rest back to? Amen? Goes all the way back to the foundations of the world. All right? And we know of that 7-day period. And if we've been looking at the timeline and my fellow brothers and sisters, as they come on, they're going to expound. They're going to go back and they're going to remind us of the timeline. We know that what happened is that God showed us the end from the beginning by way of his word. So we see here that the time, it's from the foundations of the world. And we have to understand that. What words in 4:6 imply that there is yet a future day? As we look at it, it says that it remains for some to enter. Amen. But what happened is that God is immutable. God has never changed. Amen. And what he says in the beginning, guess what happened? It's going to happen in the end. Everything that God says is going to happen. So there's a future. There's a rest that is still there, getting ready for us to inherit as God designed, as God promised us that he's going to give it to us. How does the author of the book of Hebrews encourage his readers in the same way that King David did? He says, today, if you hear his voice, harden not your hearts. In verse 7, he said it in Psalms chapter 5, 95, and in Hebrews chapter 4, he said it again. He encourages us. He said, listen, do not harden your hearts. He says over and over, do not harden your hearts. If you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. Amen. And that is consistent throughout the book. Still on page 41. In this chapter, how does the author of Hebrews exhort his readers not to look upon the rest as something that has already happened? We can go back to verse 6, and verse 6 pretty much lays it out. Since therefore it remains for some to enter it, and those who formerly had good news preached to them failed to enter because of disobedience. So we know that disobedience and unfaithfulness plays a factor, a great factor in the first generation. And God is telling us today, that it is the same thing. Disobedience and lack of faithfulness will put us in the same position. Amen, somebody. Just as the first generation Israel. So in the past, what day did the rest fall on? Genesis chapter 1. Right? Genesis chapter 2, 1 to 3, the seventh day, nothing changed. In the future, what day will the rest fall on? Seventh day, all right? And we know that the rest is always on the seventh day. Jesus Christ said it. As we look at the dispensations, we see that there are four dispensations. We saw the first three dispensations, which is man's day, and then what happened? The next dispensation, which is the seventh day. So it always falls on the seventh day, the day of rest, just as God promised. So even this passage in Hebrews chapter 4, watch this now. The Holy Spirit prompted the author to relate this day of rest back to the beginning. Amen? So the future rest for the people of God is noted as being connected with a past rest. God's rest in Genesis chapter 2, 1, 3, on the seventh day. From the beginning of scripture, this day of rest is always on the seventh day, following the 6 days of work. You see, we must begin with Moses. So in other words, we say all the time that we have to start, amen? We have to start where God started, amen? We go and we are aware of eternity past. And in eternity past, what gave us an insight of what happened in eternity past is Ezekiel chapter 28, right? It gives us an insight of what happened, where Satan was, what happened to him because of disobedience, because of, I will say, disrespecting the Lord by not abiding by his instructions. And it's pretty much the same thing. So we get an insight in what happened in eternity past. But we see in Genesis where God started. In the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Amen. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Amen. So we see that what happened, there's a past creation, ruling creation, and then God had to restore a new creation now. And then what happened is that he laid out right on the onset of time, that very moment, by way of those 6 days, that those 6 days, he laid and gave us a full understanding, a full picture of the end from the beginning. Building on the foundation, the future foretold by the past, part one. We move to day five, and we're going to wrap this up pretty much day five. I trust that what happened is that you will pay attention. As we look around us, sisters and brothers, we pay attention to what is happening around us. And it's when we pay attention and we go back to the Word of God and we match up what is happening and what God said through his Word, then we know that absolute truth is the Word of God. This is the only absolute truth that exists, his Word. We look around us and we see everything that God said in his Word. It is unfolding right before our very eyes. I want to thank you all at this time, and I'm going to move and give the others an opportunity who will stand by, who will bless our hearts as we follow. I'm going to call on Sister Morris, who is first. She'll be doing the introductory part, day one and day two, in giving the summary as we move on to day five on page 42. Sister Morris.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Good evening, everyone. I pray that God will help me to deliver this presentation with clarity and will provide us with understanding of his words. My presentation will be based on day one and day two. A day is as a thousand years. We will begin by looking at an overall timeline representing times in the past, present, and future from Genesis to Revelation. Let's take a look at the chart on page 28. Let me take a minute to review the meaning of some of the words or terms we have encountered during the study. Dispensations. It's a period of time that God dealt with different groups of people. Age. In this study, there are two ages. We have the present age, known as man's day, which is 6,000 years period when God dealt with three groups of people. He dealt with the Gentiles, the Jews, and Christians. Then there's the coming age known as the millennium, the Lord's day, which is that 1,000 years in the fourth dispensations. The other word that we will encounter, that we have encountered, is mockers. Peter refers to them as false prophets who will be mocking the return of Christ, and they also follow their own evil desires. Let's take a look at day one, part one. A day is as a thousand years. And I'm sure you're at page 28 with that chart, with the timeline. As you can see, the chart is divided into four dispensations and two ages. You will notice that the first dispensation has 2,000 years, but the second dispensation between Abraham and the second coming of Christ equates to 1,993 years. The remaining 7 years, God was dealing with Israel as a nation. And he stopped the clock because they rejected the message and the messenger. And they refused to repent from their sins. This period was known as the 7 year tribulations. As mentioned earlier, these three dispensations totaling 6,000 years are in the present age and known as man's day. Finally, the fourth and last dispensation is 1,000 years, which completes the 7,000 years. This is the coming age and is known as the Lord's Day, the millennium. Let's take a look at day two, which is part two of a day is a thousand years. The discussion on day two relates to 2 Peter 3, verses 3-10. In verse 3, Peter addresses the actions of the mockers, as we know those are the people who are unbelieving, in saying, "Know this first of all, that in the last days, mockers will come with their mocking, falling after their own lusts." Peter is saying that there will be people who say, "Jesus promised to come back, but he is nowhere to be seen." The reason they say this is because they do not want to obey God, but follow their own sinful desires. In verses 5-7, Peter asserts that the mockers have deliberately overlooked this fact that the heavens existed long ago, and the earth was formed out of water and through water by the word of God, and that the world that then existed was destroyed with water and people perished. But by the same word, the heavens and earth that now exist will be destroyed, will destroy the ungodly on the day of judgment by fire. In verse 8, Peter reminds the church that God's view of time is different from ours. We have a short life, and time is important to us. God is eternal. For him, time does not exist. Peter expounds on it in verse 8 when he says, "With the Lord, one day is a thousand years, and a thousand years as one day." Thousand years are not long for God. God has existed from eternity and will continue to exist until eternity. I must admit that I had some problem understanding the first part of the verse. Actually, it was a bit harder to understand. "With the Lord, a day is like a thousand years." However, after reading it a few times and putting the verse into context, my reasoning was, what would take us 1,000 years to do, God can do it in a day or even an instant. What is very hard to us, it takes a long time to accomplish. The Lord can do this very fast because he's almighty. In verses 9 and 10, Peter is urging his audience to regard God as patient in regard to bringing about the conclusion of his plan, rather than slow, as mentioned in the text, and not to doubt his eventual arrival. Peter reminds his readers that God created the world. The flood of Noah's day is evidence that he is willing to bring judgment on the earth for sin. God is not late. The Lord can do very fast because he's almighty, patient and merciful towards us. But the day of the Lord will come eventually like a thief in the night. Everything will be destroyed. A new heaven and earth will be established. Finally, on the bottom of page 31, I'd like for you to move to page 31 and just look at what Peter takes issue with the mockers, because they're really having false understanding of the word of God. Peter explains what escapes their notice by drawing inferences on different events in the book of Genesis, where he says, by the word of God, the heavens, I'm not going to read the whole thing, but because you have it right there on page 31. By the word of God, the Lord is not slow, that's at the bottom, and about his promise to return. I hope I have shed some light on and better understanding. It helped me to understand day one and day two better in preparing this presentation. Thank you.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Sister Morris. And thank you for summarizing day one and pretty much day two for us. And just want to go back to the mockers just a little bit, just for time. You know that their main problem, and I just want to push this out, that it was they were questioning God's timing. And even today, we're experiencing the same thing, that they're questioning God's timing. We're going to continue, and we're going to go to Sister Rita. Sister Rita will be summarizing day three for us, you know, as our study comes to a close. Sister Rita, you can go on camera if you wish.
I'll pass on the camera because I think it'll make me more nervous.
All right.
So as we review day three can be viewed from two different perspectives, as the third day or the seventh day. The account given in John 2 of the wedding, where Jesus turned the 6 pots of water into wine, is about more than just the miracle he performed. It is a preview of the future wedding that will take place at the beginning of the 1,000 years of the millennial kingdom. In the first chapter of John, the 4 daily events described are parallel with the first 4 days of God's restoration of creation after Satan's fall found in Genesis. Then John chapter 2 starts off with, and the third day, which indicates the next event occurs 3 days after the previous 4 days from John 1. This shows the third day then takes place after the 6 days of restoration for creation as well as man, and ends with God's day of rest on the 7th day, just like in Genesis chapter 2. This gives us the seventh day perspective. The third day perspective represents the culmination of the 2000 year dispensation of God dealing with the Jews, or the children of Israel, and the 2000 year dispensation of God dealing with the church. Remembering that a day is 1,000 years and 1,000 years is a day, each of these dispensations represent 2 days. Then on the third day, according to John 2:1, there is a wedding in Cana of Galilee. This third day points to the type, anti-type structure of the wedding feast that will take place in the future between God and his bride, the children of Israel, and Christ and his bride. I used to think that the phrase in 2 Peter 3:9 referred to the unsaved, where the word says that God desires that none should perish, but that we should all come to repentance. But now I realize that it is for us as believers. Therefore, each day that God tarries and spares us to see another day, we must be grateful for God's mercy and grace. We should take advantage of every opportunity to grow in the grace and knowledge of God and grow in understanding so that we can come to repentance. We, as well as the children of Israel, are given chances to repent because there is so much at stake. We could still miss out and miss the mark. Therefore, we should realize how fortunate we are to have been called and given the privilege of being able to rule and reign with Christ. I hope that helped you guys to understand the third day.
Thank you, Sister Rita. Thank you. We appreciate that summary. And we're going to move to our last day, day four, Sister Jenny. Sister Jenny?
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can. Hmm?
Okay. You've just gone through it over again. You just summarized it or taught us on it. But I did do my writing before you did that. The day of rest, what is it? It's the Lord's day, the seventh day, the Sabbath day of rest. In the past, in the beginning, God created heaven and earth in 6 days. And on the seventh day, he rested and called it the Sabbath day. And this was the only day that God specified in writing. This was a sign between God and Israel. King David wrote to the children of Israel and told them about the coming rest in the future, that there would be a coming rest in the future. This will take place in the millennial period, in the messianic period. He told the children of Israel that they forfeited their rest, just as their forefathers had done. The first rest, they forfeited. The second rest, with Joshua going into Cana, they fell short also, and that was forfeited because of their disobedience, unbelief, and unfaithfulness. But there's the rest in the future, the millennial rest. This is in Hebrew. The author in Hebrews warned the church not to ignore God's words, but to be faithful and obedient. Because if we follow the children of Israel, it's a possibility of missing out on the future rest. The rest yet future, Christ will lead his people in the heavenly promised land with his bride and they will rule all the nations. We are warned, and we should not, we should listen as children of God if we want to inherit the kingdom, be overcomers. We just have to have a relationship, continued relationship with the Lord, and do what the Lord's word said we should do. Be obedient to his word. And that is it.
Amen. Thank you, Sister Jenny. Thank you, Sister Morris. Thank you, Sister Rita. And thank you, Sister Jenny. You know, it gives me joy. It gives me joy, you know, when you can teach and, you know, somebody can just express themselves and give you their understanding. You know, I know that it's a lot of material, but I am blessed tonight that just to hear you guys summarize everything that you were taught over these couple of weeks, I am really overjoyed. And of course it is, sometimes you want to hear exactly, you know, if people are grasping whatever has been taught, you know. So I am blessed tonight, and I just thank you guys, and I'm going to ask that we continue to read this study, we continue to go through the study, we continue, there's some very very important information. Go back to that chart, understand that chart, because what happened, you should be able to teach that chart, you know, to tell people what Christ, what the Lord says through his word, right? I want to prepare your hearts just next week, as I said, just prepare your hearts, you know, as if the Lord tarries, and we move on to page 45, which we're going to be continuing from the beginning to the end, part one on a salvation ready to be revealed. Sisters and brothers, let me tell you, it intensifies. It gets deeper as we go along. But I believe that God has blessed us that he can give us a framework. He has given us the framework. He has given us knowledge of what he wants to give us. And we're going to move in now to a salvation ready to be revealed. I'm going to put something to you. Just remember that the spirit salvation, spiritual, is different from soul salvation. Bear this in mind, that once again, I said it today, that whatever you do as a child of God, I want to just make sure that I just grant you comfort tonight, that the salvation that God has given you, you being vivified, you being made alive, nobody can take that away from you. As a matter of fact, not even if you want to give up your salvation, you can't give it up. Why? Because this is something that God has given you. God, by way of Jesus Christ, made that sacrifice. He paid the ultimate price. And that salvation you have accepted was given to you. But what you do on earth, it doesn't stop there. What you do now will pretty much let you know what you will earn later on. Because when we stand before God, our works will be judged. And of course it is, then we're going to move on to a salvation ready to be revealed. Each man, each one of us must examine ourselves. Each one of us must deny self, take up the cross, and guess what? Your loyalty, my sisters and brothers, it's about him. Your loyalty is to him. Amen? So keep your mind stayed on him. Maintain your focus as we press on, as the Holy Spirit of God reveal, as the Holy Spirit of God shape us, as the Holy Spirit of God get us ready. Just remember that you have a responsibility. Revelation chapter 19, to make yourselves ready. Amen? Amen, as we press on. May the Lord bless you tonight, and I'll see you next week if the Lord tarries. Father, we thank you, Lord God, for your blessings. Thank you for the study tonight. Thank you for my sisters, Lord God, who, Lord, volunteer, Lord God, to summarize. It gives me joy, Lord. I'm blessed. I'm honored, Father God, that, Lord, we can teach, and, Father, somebody can come back, and they can relate certain things just to give you, to tell them what they grasp, Lord God, from what was taught. I give you thanks and praise tonight. We give you honor and praise in Jesus' name. God bless you all.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Anthony. Thank you, Dr. Morris and Sister Rita and Sister Jenny. I want to thank you all. I want to thank those who came on tonight. We have Zoom to study with us. If you came for the first time, we just want to welcome you to Valley Stream Baptist Church Bible study. What a blessing it is to be able to come and share God's word with you. All right. I want to remind you that we're looking forward to October the 4th when we are going to be meeting back here for our first service. And that service will be starting at 11 o'clock. And it will, we'll probably be done. We want to be done by 12. And we're going to be asking that if you decide to come as usual, make sure that you text Sister Patricia and let her know about the number. Can we put up that number again tonight if possible so that they could have this number and you'll be able to text, just let us know how many of you will be here that Sunday, because there's a certain amount that we'll be able to take, and we would like to know that ahead of time so that we'll be able to let others know to plan for the following week. So the number is 516-690-9434. I'll repeat that, 516-690-9434. I want to do that again. 516-690-9434. And you can also go on the website and look at information in relation to phase one as we try to work our way back here. Something else I want to say. Okay, on that first Sunday of October, our service starts at 11, but we're going to be asking if you can get here by 10:30 so that we'll be able to get organized and get in, because we're going to start at 11 o'clock sharp. Once it's 11 o'clock, we're going to jump around the piano, whatever it is, and we're going to begin to do something here in terms of our worship. All right, so I'll give you some more information as time goes along. And may the Lord continue to be with you. And may the Lord continue to bless you. Any announcement, anything you need to add to that? Sure. All right. Okay. So she's reminding me that we need to pray for Dwayne. He's supposed to be coming back this way, that the Lord will work out his purpose and his plan. Again, I just want to seriously thank everyone for, you know, the sincere efforts that you've made for this ministry to continue to function in the manner in which it is. We just want to praise God for the gifts he's given you so you'll be able to utilize them to his glory. The many who are far away from us, whether you're in Florida, you're in Jamaica, wherever you are in the world, we thank God for you again, and we certainly appreciate your presence with us. And please tell somebody about our service. All right. Make sure that there's somebody, if you're going to give anyone the information, make sure that there's somebody that you know and somebody that you trust in terms of a believer. Amen. And we want to spread the word. But we're looking for a grand time and October the 4th as we come together to celebrate the table of the Almighty God, to be reminded of the death Christ died for us. All right. We're going to let you go. Pastor Anthony already prayed. And so I'm just going to just let you go. Blessings on you, and God be with you. May his blessings continue to be upon you. Bye-bye.